Welcome back to very interesting topic, that is Hodgkin's disease. Initially, remember my friends, this is known as Hodgkin's lymphoma, but nowadays it is considered as Hodgkin's disease because the cause for this Hodgkin's is nowadays it is well established that it is the Epstein-Barr virus. So like any other viral infection, here also patient will have a fever, night sweats, lymphadenopathy. So the new term they have coined is the Hodgkin's disease. Even if you call it as Hodgkin's lymphoma, that's not much wrong as such. We have to differentiate Hodgkin's from the non-Hodgkin's. Non-Hodgkin's lymphomas are the one which will not show the peculiar cell is the RS cells, Reed Steinberg cell. So that is the cell which differentiates Hodgkin's from the non-Hodgkin's. Whenever we get a slide of Hodgkin's lymphoma or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, a lymphoma, the diagnosis mainly based on the presence or absence of the RS cell. If we see RS cells, it is Hodgkin's disease. If we don't see RS cells, it is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So that is the importance of this Reed Steinberg cells. We keep on looking, searching for these RS cells. Sometimes in NHL, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, we get RS-like cells, which almost looks like RS cells, but they are not RS cells. So we have immunohistochemistry markers like CD15 and CD30, which will help. They will come for our rescue to differentiate the RS cell from the RS-like cells. So let us have the look on the very interesting pathogenesis of Hodgkin's disease, the role of Reed Steinberg cells and how they attract so many the other inflammatory cells, mainly eosinophils, and let us have a look on the pathogenesis of this particular disease. Hodgkin's lymphoma or Hodgkin's disease. So as such, lymphomas are always malignant. There is nothing like a benign lymphoma. So these malignant lymphomas are classified under two main broad headings: Hodgkin's lymphoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. This chart you need to understand in detail. This is a very important chart. Hodgkin's lymphoma, whenever we call, it always involves or it starts with a single axial group of lymphadenopathy. For example, either cervical group of lymph nodes will be involved or axillary group of lymph nodes are involved. So it always starts with a single group of lymphadenopathy. That's why prognosis is very, very good for Hodgkin's lymphoma. Whereas non-Hodgkin's lymphomas will always present with a multiple group of lymphadenopathy. So at the same time, patient will have axillary, cervical, inguinal, pre-aortic, para-aortic. So multiple group of lymph nodes will be involved with the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So this is how it is very important clinical point. Second is, you can predict the spread of Hodgkin's lymphoma because it spreads by contiguity. That means you can tell, yes, which group of lymph nodes are going to get involved next. You can predict that in Hodgkin's disease, whereas you cannot predict the spread of the disease in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Most of the time, mesenteric and Waldeyer's group of lymph nodes are not involved in the Hodgkin's lymphomas, whereas very, very commonly they are get involved in the non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. Extranodal spread is almost never seen in the Hodgkin's disease, but it is very common in the non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. Extranodal means apart from lymph nodes, anywhere else. For example, gastric lymphomas, CNS lymphomas. So that is very common in the non-Hodgkin's lymphomas, never seen in the Hodgkin's disease as such. So by that clinical point identification points, you can differentiate Hodgkin's lymphoma from the non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. What is the definition of this Hodgkin's disease? It is a tumor lesions and comprises of the group of lymphoid neoplasms as such that will differ from non-Hodgkin's lymphoma by presentation is as good as any infections, like due to the presence of fever and presence of night sweats, presence of lymphadenopathy. So you feel as if patient is suffering from viral infections, but later on you will come to realize that it is the Hodgkin's disease. No leukemic stage. This is very important. Non-Hodgkin's lymphomas can have a leukemias. Leukemia can turn into lymphoma. Whereas Hodgkin's lymphoma, they don't have any leukemic stage. And arising the single node. So it always starts as a one group of lymphadenopathy. Excise that group, the disease is totally cured, like that. Or you can predict the spread of that Hodgkin's lymphoma. It will spread to the next group of lymph nodes and spread in a contiguous lymph node. So it is possible to predict the spread of the disease. So characteristically, it spreads to the contiguous group of lymph nodes. The most important finding for a pathology point of view is the presence of the Reed-Sternberg cell, what we call it as RS cells. And that is a distinctive neoplastic giant cell, which is said to be B cell origin. You know, initially, there are a lot of research publications have been carried out, whether it is a B cell origin, a T cell origin, or a monocytic origin. So finally, it is proved that the RS cells are derived from the germinal centers of the, and they belong to the B lymphocytic series. So it is B cell in origin. That point you have to remember, RS cells belong to the B cell in origin. Extranodal spread is very, very uncommon. That's what I told. So it is most of the time limited to the lymph nodes only. So this, by these characteristic features, you can differentiate Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And if these features are there, then it is a case of Hodgkin's lymphoma. Yes, it constitutes around 0.7% cases of all new cases in US, and constitute around 50% of malignant lymphomas. That means 50% will be Hodgkin's, 50% will be non-Hodgkin's. So like that, incidence is bimodal. Young adults are very commonly get affected, and nowadays it is totally curative because we have good chemotherapeutic drugs, and even surgical resection sometimes itself is a curative if it is limited to single group of axial group of lymph nodes. What is most important from pathology point of view is classification of Hodgkin's lymphoma. We classify into five headings as such: nodular sclerosis, mixed cellularity, lymphocyte depletion, lymphocyte predominant, and lymphocyte rich. So I am going to tell about these five types of Hodgkin's disease. The four types, the nodular sclerosis, mixed cellularity, lymphocyte depletion, and lymphocyte predominant are called as classical type, whereas the fifth type is called as non-classical Hodgkin's lymphoma. If at all you see the lymph nodes that are involved, they are very, very large in size, somewhere around 2 centimeters, 3 centimeters, or up to 5 centimeters in size. So cervical group of lymph nodes are more commonly involved. So most frequently, the cervical group of lymph nodes, very huge lymphadenopathy. So they are rubbery in consistency, and they are discrete, not matted. Matted group of lymph nodes are seen in the tuberculosis. So these are rubbery in consistency. Whenever the patient will come with such a huge lymphadenopathy, clinicians will be in a doubt whether it is a tubercular lymphadenitis or is it a metastatic lymph node, metastatic deposits of some other carcinomas, or whether it is a lymphoma. If lymphoma, is it a Hodgkin's lymphoma or non-Hodgkin's lymphomas? So whenever we see big lymph nodes in the neck, so we have to do several investigations to conclude whether it is, what it is actually. Is it a tuberculosis or a Hodgkin's or a non-Hodgkin's? So very classically in Hodgkin's lymphomas, there will be peculiar complaint that if the patient is alcoholic, if patient takes alcohol, they will have a tender lymph node. So these lymph nodes will become very, very tender in Hodgkin's disease. So this history you can ask only if the patient is alcoholic. So you cannot ask in all the patients. Cut section of the lymph nodes will show peculiarly gray tan or pale tan in appearance. There will not be much areas of hemorrhage or necrosis in the Hodgkin's or even in the non-Hodgkin's. And microscopically, what is the most important is presence of the neoplastic cell, that is Reed-Sternberg cells. That should be present in appropriate background of non-neoplastic inflammatory cells. See the words that are used here. So RS cells should be present in the appropriate background of non-neoplastic inflammatory cells. That means you should also look for these cells, that is lymphocyte plasma cells, and the most important cell is the eosinophils. So Hodgkin's lymphoma, we always search for the eosinophils. So whenever in a lymph node sections, we keep on, whenever eosinophils are seen, then we look for Hodgkin's cells. So vice versa also true, that whenever we see RS cells, we also look for the eosinophils. So eosinophils are the most important cells along with RS cells. So both you can call it as friends. They talk to each other and they will do the party with each other. So this Reed-Sternberg cell, how it appears? It is the true neoplastic element of the Hodgkin's disease. Classical RS cells are around 15 to 45 micron in size. and the nucleus is binucleated or bilobed. So that's why it is called as ovoid appearance of a nucleus or a mirror image appearance of a nucleus. So ovoid appearance, mirror image appearance is very classical of these Reed-Sternberg cells. Nucleus contains very large nucleoli. We call it as inclusion like nucleoli, ovoid nucleoli surrounded by a clear halo. So perinucleolar clear halo. So that's the one what you have to remember. So this is very large cell, around 15 to 45 micron in size. So usually around 30 microns in size on an average. So it contains two nucleus. This is one nucleus, this is the second nucleus. So nucleoli will be so large, it is almost the size of the small lymphocyte, as it's around 7 micron in size. Large macronucleoli, and classically it is eosinophilic. Eosinophilic macronucleoli. So in HND sections, prominent, very striking macronucleoli is the characteristic feature of these RSS, and they show perinuclear clear halo. Perinucleolar clear halo. So this is mirror image appearance or ovoid appearance of the RSLs. So once you start seeing the RSLs, then you keep on seeing plenty of RSLs will come into your notice that you are dealing with the Hodgkin's disease. Once you see RSLs, then you will see plenty of RSLs. So not only classical type, there are so many other types of variants of RSLs that makes sometimes it's a diagnostic challenge for the pathologist. Cytoplasm is moderate to abundant, and it is amphiphilic, that is neither eosinophilic nor basophilic. We use the word amphiphilic. And to differentiate RS cells from the other RS like cells, we have IHC markers. So nowadays we will not much struggle, we will use the help of these our immunohistochemistry markers. CD15 and CD30 are the most important IHC markers. This they will commonly ask in the exams, that RSLs are positive for CD15 and CD30. So they are the IHC markers for definitive diagnosis of the RSLs. It will be positive only for the RSLs. Yes, have a look at this particular lymph node section. Is it Hodgkin's lymphoma or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma? So we have to carefully search. And whenever we see binucleated cell, yes, we look for the prominent eosinophilic nucleoli. So this is very classical RSLs. So along with that, you can see the mononuclear cells. So this we call it as Hodgkin's cell as such. So very prominent nucleoli is there, macro eosinophilic nucleoli is there, but it is single. So such a cells are called as Hodgkin's cells. This is Reed-Sternberg cell. So along with that, we have to also look for the eosinophils, of course, less in this field. Yes, so this is how diagrammatically you have to represent. So classical RSL with a prominent eosinophilic macronucleoli, perinucleolar clear halo, and binucleated cells, ovoid appearance or a mirror image appearance. So you should also look for the accompanying eosinophils, accompanying plenty of eosinophils, sometimes even neutrophils, macrophages. So all those cells, even fibroblast. So fibroblast, if they are excessive, they forms the nodular configuration of the entire lymph node. We call it as nodular sclerosing variant of Hodgkin's lymphoma. Yes, variants of RSLs can be seen, and this is the one which makes us, you know, classical RSL is the one which we have seen, but there are so many types like mononuclear variant. Lacunar variant is the one where the cytoplasm appears totally empty like, so they are lacunar variant. Mononuclear variant, which appears like a monocyte. So monocyte like mononuclear variant are the one which is where they will not have binucleated. So it is single nucleus, very large macronucleoli will be there, eosinophilic. That is the one which is again mononuclear variant. And L and H variant, that is lacunar and histocytic variant. So that's the one which we also call it as popcorn cell. So it's a multinucleated and appears like a popcorn. So they are the three types, other types of the RSLs. Remember, my friends, it is possible to predict the spread of a Hodgkin's disease. So spread is predictable. Based on that, we can do even the staging of the Hodgkin's disease. That is the one which is more important than the histological subtypes. So the five types of Hodgkin's disease is more of interest for the pathologist, but what is more important from prognostic point of view is the staging. So you can predict a spread. You can say that lymph node disease precedes the splenic involvement, splenic disease precedes the liver involvement, liver disease precedes the bone marrow involvement and extranodal involvement. So first and foremost is the lymph nodes are the one which are get affected, then the spleen is get affected, then the liver will be get affected, and finally it is the bone that is get affected. So in a cases of Hodgkin's lymphoma, bone marrow biopsy is the must, right? So we also do rarely the lymph node biopsy is the must. We also do the bone marrow biopsy to mainly for staging of a disease. So if the bone marrow is involved, then it is at the final stage of a disease process. So Ann Arbor staging is based on the how many lymph nodes are actually get involved. So we remember this name, Ann Arbor classification is mainly for the it is for the distribution of the disease as such, the Hodgkin's disease. So if there is involvement of a single lymph node, it is a stage 1. Involvement of the two lymph nodes or more than two lymph nodes but on the same side of diaphragm, then it is stage 2. Stage 3, where lymph nodes are get involved on the both side of the diaphragm, it is stage 3. And disseminated foci of involvement, especially the bone marrow involvement, is the stage 4. Yes, let us have a look on the various types of histological subtypes of the Hodgkin's disease. Nodular sclerosis is the one which is very, very common. Around 75% of the cases are belong to the nodular sclerosis variant. So as the term sclerosis indicates, there will be plenty of deposition of the collagen by the fibroblast. So you will see the collagen bands dividing the lymph node architecture into multiple nodules. So dense sclerosis, fibrosis will be seen that divides the lymph node into multiple nodules. So classical RSLs, along with that you can see good number of lacunar type of RSLs, and you will see the accompanying cells, that is friends of RSLs. Also you will see eosinophils, plasma cells, macrophages and lymphocytes. Very commonly lymph nodes, cervical group of lymph nodes, supracollicular group of lymph nodes, mediastinal lymph nodes are get involved. Women are commonly get affected, usually in adolescent age. Young adults are commonly get affected, like students 20 to 30 years of age, they will also come with a lymphadenopathy. You should suspect about the nodular sclerosis of Hodgkin's lymphomas. So RSL variant is, lacunar cell variant is very commonly seen under microscope. So apart from classical variant, even you can make out the lacunar type of RSLs are also can be seen in the nodular sclerosis. In mixed cellularity, as the name indicates, not only RSLs will be plenty, RSLs and even mononuclear variants will be plenty. You will see plenty of eosinophils, small lymphocytes, plasma cells, and you will not see much sclerosis. So then we call it as mixed cellularity. Usually it is more common in the men and elderly male, and it is usually having a not much favorable prognosis, usually present with the advanced tumor stage. Lymphocyte predominant is the one which constitute around 6% of the cases. Nodal effacement by vaguely infiltration of the small lymphocytes admixed with the benign histocytes can occur. So classical RSLs can be seen very few, but very classical about lymphocyte predominant is the popcorn cell, what we call it as L and H type, is very commonly seen in the lymphocyte predominant. Men less than 35 years of age can be commonly get affected. And this is how the popcorn cells, you have a look at this popcorn cells. So apart from classical RSLs, we can see multinucleated popcorn cells like this, and you will have plenty of eosinophils, lymphocytes, plasma cells, accompanying cells with that. Lymphocyte depletion, as the name indicates, is the one which will have very less population of lymphocytes and plenty of classic RSLs. So this is, remember, this is the one with the worst prognosis. Worst prognosis will be there for the lymphocyte depletion variant. Few lymphocytes, plenty of RSLs. So probably prognosis varies indirectly with the number of RSLs. Then let us have a look on what is the pathogenesis of this particular disease. Remember, etiological factor, Epstein-Barr virus, I will tell about it. RSLs are known to secrete variety of cytokines, mainly interleukin-4, 5, TNF, that is tumor necrosis factor alpha, granulocyte, monocyte, colony-stimulating factor, and even tumor growth factor beta. So all these cytokines that are secreted by the RSLs will attract the variety of non-neoplastic reactive cells. So let us have a look on this beautiful animation. RSLs, they will cross react with other types of cells, mainly by secreting interleukin-6. It will attract the plasma cells. By interleukin-5 and interleukin-13, it secretes the that is secreted by the RSLs, it attracts the eosinophils. That's why eosinophils are seen plenty in the cases of Hodgkin's disease. and it secretes the fibrogenic growth factor and tumor growth factor, so that will attract the fibroblast. They are the one which are responsible for the laying down of the collagen tissue. And by secreting interleukin 5, it attracts the lymphocytes, interleukin 4 and interleukin 10. And colony granulocyte monocyte colony stimulating factor is the one which will attract the histiocytes or the tissue macrophages, and lymphocytes also will be get attracted. So this is how the RSL is able to cross react. So this is what we call it as cross reacting RSL, talking of the eosinophils. So try to remember the pathogenesis of the Hodgkin's disease. It is mainly caused by Epstein-Barr virus, which will give a trigger for the cells to grow the cells with a monoclonal population of a cells. So once there is a formation of these modified, the RSLs belongs to the B lymphocytic series. So this is actually a B cell lineage derived. So these RSLs will cross react with all the other non-neoplastic population of cells. So by secreting interleukin 5, it attracts the eosinophils. By secreting interleukin 6, it attracts the plasma cells. And by secreting the fibrogenic growth factor, it induces plenty of collagen tissue deposition, especially in the nodular sclerosis. Mainly fibroblasts are the one which will lay down the collagen fibers. And T lymphocytes will get attracted by interleukin 4. And granulocyte monocyte colony stimulating factor, it attracts the tissue macrophages. So this is how they explain the pathogenesis of the Hodgkin's disease as such. So this is cell talking between RSLs and different non-neoplastic population of the cells in the Hodgkin's disease. Remember, nowadays it is well established that the etiology for Hodgkin's disease is the Epstein-Barr virus. So what it does, it causes the liberation of the oncoprotein, so called as latent membrane protein 1, LMP1. So that oncoprotein is get secreted, that is the one which triggers the activation. It gives the mitogenic signals. So nuclear factor KB is get activated. So the cells will keep on dividing without proper signals. So that's how the monoclonal population of cells will grow. Let us have a science clinical features of Hodgkin's disease. Usually younger patients, they are the one who will have a more favorable histological factor types. Stage 1 and stage 2 will have very good prognosis. And if there is no systemic symptoms like night sweats and weight loss and the fever, all those things constitute as systemic symptoms. If there are no systemic symptoms, then patient will have a very good prognosis. Disseminated disease, stage 3 and stage 4, and mixillarity and lymphocyte depletion, then presence of systemic symptoms, all this will carry a bad prognostic indicator. So stage 4, mixillarity, lymphocyte depletion, presence of systemic symptoms, night sweats and a fever, then it is a bad prognostic indicator. One of the points you have to remember, there will be a pain in the lymph nodes on consumption of alcohol. Why it occurs, we don't know exactly, but it is very peculiar clinical feature in the Hodgkin's disease. So prognosis actually depends on the staging more than importantly than the histological types. But somehow you just try to remember that lymphocyte predominant will have best prognosis, then followed by nodular sclerosis, then followed by mixillarity. The least favorable prognosis or the poor prognosis will be there for the lymphocyte depletion. Remember the point, tumor staging is more important than the histological subtype. So staging is the one which will decide the treatment and the prognosis. So with the proper treatment with the type stage 1 and stage 2, cure rate is as high as 90%. That's how you have to differentiate Hodgkin's from the non-Hodgkin's. And with the stage 4 A and B, that is with the presence of clinical signs and symptoms, 5-year disease free survival is almost, it comes down to 60 to 70%. But still Hodgkin's disease will have more and more better prognosis as compared to the non-Hodgkin's disease. So that's how we have to differentiate, is it you are dealing with the Hodgkin's disease or a non-Hodgkin's disease. That makes us to more intensely look in the histological slide. Where is RSL? Where is RSL? Where is RSL? So we always look for this our friend RSL and its friend, that is the eosinophils, plasma cells, neutrophils and the tissue histocytes. So that's about interesting story of the Hodgkin's disease.